Education for Life. This is Ritika. So it's been quite a long time that we studied chemistry, I guess. So let's finish the chapter which we were dealing with, matter in our surroundings. We have already completed two parts of this chapter. And the first part, we studied about the introduction, what is matter, and characteristics of particles of matter. And in the second part, we studied about the states of matter, which is solid state, liquid state, and gaseous state. And in this part, we will look into something even more interesting, which is change in state of matter. Okay, so let's move into the video. So basically, how this change in state of matter can be brought about. So there are basically two different factors. One is temperature, which is heat, and the other one is pressure. Okay, so first we'll look how temperature influences the change in state of matter. What happens when we heat ice? So when we heat ice, at a point of time, it gets converted into water. And on further heating, water gets converted into water vapor. So what actually happens? When the temperature increases, kinetic energy of the particles also increases. What is kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is nothing but movement of the particles. We have already seen that there is a force of attraction between these particles of matter. So what happens is, when we give heat, the heat overcomes or it breaks the force of attraction between particles. So when the force of attraction between particles becomes feeble, the matter is not rigid. So when the matter is not rigid, the particles move freely. And at this point of time, solid state is converted into liquid state. And this process of conversion of solid state to liquid state is called as melting. Okay, so to be very simple, you can see in this picture. So in this picture, we have solid state and there are many particles which are closely arranged, right? So here, the force of attraction is larger. So the symbol indicates heating. On heating the solid, you can see in the second picture, what happens to the liquid? The particles in the liquid are freely arranged, right? Why it is freely arranged? Because the force of attraction between the particles of liquid is very less compared to solid. So that is why liquids are freely arranged. So this conversion of solid to liquid based on the force of attraction of particles by giving heat or temperature is called as melting. So this melting does not occur at the very moment you heat the solid. Okay, so there is a minimum temperature. The minimum temperature at which a solid melts to become a liquid at atmospheric pressure is called melting point. Here, we are only raising the temperature of the solid, or we are only raising the temperature. We are not changing the pressure. The pressure remains constant. So melting point, there is another definition you can see here. Melting point of a solid is an indication of the strength of the force of attraction between its particles. So the melting point of ice here is 273.16 Kelvin. Exactly at this temperature, the solid ice changes into liquid water. So in this process, one point to be noted when the ice is heated. We can see that overall temperature of the system remains constant. There is no increase in temperature. So then, where does all these heat go into? The heat we give gets hidden in the contents of the beaker. And this is called as latent heat of fusion. So the definition goes this way. So the amount of heat energy that is required to change 1 kilogram of a solid into liquid at atmospheric pressure at its melting point is known as latent heat of fusion. So now we have formed water from ice, right? So which means the solid state is converted into liquid state. And we have found that this process is called as melting, right? So now we need to convert the water into water vapor. So what we should do now, we should continue the heating. Already in liquid state, the force of attraction between particles is less. So even more heating will cause very feeble, very, very feeble force of attraction between particles. And therefore, water gets converted into water vapor. That is, liquid state is converted into gaseous state. And this process is called as evaporation. So in the picture, it is very clear that when we compare with the liquid state, the gaseous state, the particles have very, very less force of attraction, and therefore they are able to move very freely. And this process of conversion of liquid to gas is called as evaporation. Okay, so in the first picture, this is an overall idea of what are the processes involving in it and how the solid changes into liquid and liquid changes into gas. Okay. So we have seen about melting point. Then what is about this boiling point? Boiling point is nothing but the temperature at which a liquid starts boiling at the atmospheric pressure is known as its boiling point. For water, the boiling temperature is 373 Kelvin. Okay. So moving on to the next topic. Till now, we have seen the influence of temperature in changing the states of matter. Now, we look how pressure works. Here, we concentrate on that is solid state getting converted into gaseous state and gaseous state getting converted into solid state. So this process is called as sublimation. So in the picture, you can see here, solid directly getting converted into gas without going into the liquid state is called as sublimation. And the reverse of this, that is gas without moving into the liquid state, getting directly converted into solid state is also called as sublimation. Okay. So here we are taking the example as CO2. CO2, we know, it is a gas. It is present in the atmosphere, right? So now this CO2 can exist in solid state also. And that CO2 existing in solid state is called as dry ice. So how we are doing it? Again, one same principle is followed everywhere. Force of attraction. So see, here you can see in the first picture, there is a gas. So we have less force of attraction between molecules or the particles, and therefore they are free. So when we give high pressure by this piston, what happens? The force of attraction between particles becomes, you know, greater. That is, they're even more becoming rigid on applying greater pressure. So at a point of time, this gas gets converted into solid. So this is how pressure plays an important role in converting solid into gaseous state. And this process, as we saw, is called as sublimation process. Okay. So now moving into the next topic, factors affecting evaporation. So what is evaporation? Evaporation is nothing but liquid state getting converted into gaseous state is called as evaporation. Okay. So first we'll take temperature. See, without even giving temperature also, water may evaporate. But why we give temperature? Because whenever we give temperature, the rate of evaporation will be faster. For example, without temperature, if the liquid is getting converted into gaseous state within 5 minutes, then while giving temperature, the time may reduce. Like within 2 minutes, it may get converted. So this is the basic idea. For example, take the wet clothes. Okay. So we are going to dry the wet clothes. So on a sunny day, the clothes dry very fast. Why? Because there is a temperature, there is a heat, natural heat, which is coming from the source, that is sun. So therefore they will dry very fast. But on a rainy day, that will take time. But on rainy days also, the clothes get dry, but it will take a very long time. So what happens on a rainy day? What exactly is that? Rainy day, in the sense, there is a humidity in the climate, right? So when there is an increase in humidity, of course, the rate of evaporation decreases. So the same example also applies in the second point, which is decrease in humidity. So whenever there is a decrease in humidity, that is, you know, more sunny day, okay, nothing but more sunny day, the rate of evaporation increases. That's it. Next, coming to the increase in wind speed. So in case of windy day, again, the evaporation is faster, or else you need to dry your hair. Now, after a bath, you need to dry your hair. What do? You use a dryer. Why do you want to use a dryer? Because the wind speed. So because of the increase in wind speed, the evaporation will be faster. But even though if you did not use a dryer, your hair will automatically get dry. But that will take a bit of time. That will take a long time. Okay. And next, increase in surface area. So when there is a large surface area, again, evaporation is easier. So for example, we take the same example. Drying the wet clothes is an example for all of these. Okay. So this is how, or these are the various factors which will affect the evaporation, which will affect the rate of evaporation. Okay. So now we're coming to the very last end of the topic and the lesson also, which is effects of cooling. How does this cooling happen? Okay, why does this cooling happen, or where does this cooling come from? Whenever there is evaporation, there is cooling happen, right? Whenever something is evaporated, there is a process called cooling which is happening. We'll take few examples. The first example is, after a hot sunny day, people sprinkle water on the roof or open ground. Why do they do it? Because water evaporates and it takes all the energy from the ground. What is the energy? That is the heat energy from the ground, leaving the cool surface behind. So therefore, evaporation can cause cooling. Next, what happens when you pour some acetone? Acetone is nothing but the nail polish remover we use on your palm. See, acetone is a volatile liquid. What is meaning of a volatile? Volatile is something which will evaporate very quickly. So acetone is a volatile liquid, and it easily evaporates at room temperature. So when we put acetone on your palm, it evaporates and the palm feels very cool. Why? Why? Because it absorbs the heat energy from the palm. Thereby, we will be able to feel the cooling effect. And next, the last one. Why should we wear cotton clothes in summer? Cotton fabric has a very special characteristic, right? It is a good absorber. Why you need to wear cotton clothes? Because it will absorb the sweat from the body. So what is sweat made up of? Because it is of all water and salts, right? So it will absorb the sweat and it will expose it to atmosphere, because we are wearing and we are moving here and there, right? So we are being exposed to atmosphere. So this cotton fabric will absorb the sweat and exposing it to the atmosphere for easy evaporation. And that is why we need to wear, you know, cotton clothes in summer. We should not wear woolen clothes in summer, because wearing woolen clothes will make us feel even more sweaty, but not cool. Okay. So these are the various topics that we have seen in this part 3 of the video. And this is the end of the chapter. So by this part 3 of the video, we have completed one whole chapter, which is matter in our surroundings. To talk about the summary, in the first video, we have already seen what is matter, characteristics of particles of matter. And in the second video, we saw about the states of matter, which is solid, liquid, and gas. And in the third video, which is this video, we have seen change in states of matter, factors affecting evaporation, and effects of cooling. So if you like the video, please don't forget to share and subscribe and like. Thank you.